Good evening and welcome to Poets Pause. My name is Marilyn Klimcho. I'll be your host for this evening. I'd like to remind my viewers that Berks Bards has an open mic event, usually every first Thursday of the month at 6 p.m. in the Goggle Works. A lovely opportunity to share your poetry and join the very widening community of poets in Berks County. So my guest is a Berks County native. Her name is Susan Pena. She's a music critic and an art journalist living in Exeter Township now. Grew up in what? You said the Twin Valley?
Robeson Township.
Robeson Township.
Yeah.
She wrote for the Reading Eagle, excuse me, from 1986 to 2020. And she now does freelance writing and a lot of poetry writing with some creative fiction thrown in.
A little bit.
That
a
is
little bit.
Interesting.
I'm dipping my toe in.
She's a member of the Berks Bards board, and she hosts the open mic for the first Thursdays that I mentioned earlier. She's had her poetry published in Bards, Pennsylvania Bards Eastern PA Poetry Review, the Schuylkill Valley Journal, and Bards for Hunger 10-year anthology. And I understand you're also having some poetry published in Gargoyle this spring.
That's right.
Yeah. We don't want to cut off Gargoyle, so we won't read those poems. But I became aware that Susan was really, really, really offended by the book banning that has taken place in recent years, and I see a lot of your stuff posted on Facebook, and I thought, you know what? This is a perfect topic because you and I both host and produce a program on BCTV called Pub Date with an Author. Mm-hmm. And some of our, excuse me, some of our authors probably would end up on the banned list if...
Undoubtedly.
Yeah.
I think we all would.
Yes, yes. Yeah. So just to give you some idea, in 2020 to 2021 school year, this is something I pulled off of the internet, Genderqueer, a memoir, was banned 41 times. All Boys Aren't Blue was banned 29 times. Out of Darkness by Ashley Hope Perez was banned 24 times. The Bluest Eye by Toni Morrison was banned 22 times. The Hate U Give by Angie Thomas was banned 17 times. Lawn Boy was banned 17 times. The Absolutely True Diary of a Part-Time Indian was banned 16 times, and the list goes on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So what led you, aside from, I'm assuming, your relationship to authors through PubDate, what led you to write about banned books?
Well, books have always been such a huge part of my life. I was an only child, and, you know, books were my friends. And I grew up, fortunately, with parents who had a lot of books of all kinds around the house. And I don't remember once being told that I couldn't read something.
Right. I remember my household was similar in that regard.
Uh-huh.
We might get to a library once a month, the public library. School libraries, you could pick a book. But a more general library, I only got to about once a month. But we had a lot of books. And I remember the very first book that crossed my path where I'm going like, wait a minute, this information might not be true. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
and I began to question and think about it. It was an anti-evolution book, which I have no idea how my parents had that in their bookshelf, but I found it. And I was like, what?
Oh yeah, I found all kinds of things. And I read books that probably would be considered inappropriate.
Mm-hmm.
For someone my age, but it was fine. I was not harmed by any of the things that I read. My parents never even dreamed of banning me from reading anything. And so I started to become aware of book banning way before now. I mean, now it seems to be really going through a hot streak, but there were always banned books.
Right.
And when I found out about the Holocaust and how the Nazis would not just ban books, they would burn them.
Yeah.
That became a signal to me of what authoritarian governments do.
Right.
And anytime a government of any, you know, of any level, local or state or national, when they start banning books, that is a very bad sign.
Yeah.
Because what they are doing is they're withholding information from people.
Right. And they're also stifling conversation.
Absolutely.
You know, because the flat earthers, they have a point to make. Mm-hmm. It may not be something consistent with what we've discovered when we go exploring space, but
true. Yes. Yeah.
But
evolution,
right,
of course, is another issue that comes up and comes up. And, you know, that's what really got me started with this. And I saw that the Diary of Anne Frank mm-hmm. was on the banned list again. And so the first banned book poem I wrote was about that, because that was a very important book.
Why don't you share that one with us?
I can do that.
All right.
Okay, be careful, it might be inappropriate. You know, it's pretty heavy. Okay. It's called Banned Book. It's on the list again. The Diary of a Young Girl. Too hot to handle. She wrote truth about her changing body, dissed her mother, told how she loved a girlfriend, kissed Peter at 14. Bad influence on children. I read it when I was younger than Anna and never forgot. A girl like me, lonely, hidden away, a writer. I started a diary, Dear Anna, as she wrote, Dear Kitty. Each June, I would read her diary, beginning it on her birthday. The book is dangerous for those who would erase memory, dangerous to read her words, dangerous to feel her fear, the silence of the hiding place where one cough could mean death, dangerous to feel her heart pounding at the sound of footsteps at night, the clomping of shiny boots on the sidewalk. I could see the sun shining off the Vester Torrent from her attic window, hear the scratching of her pen on all those pages, scattered by the clomping men when they came and took her and her family away. Dangerous to find out later what happened to her in detail. Sitting in the school library weeping, reading an old Life magazine, the trains, the shaved heads, the nauseous smells of sickness, of burning bodies, as she and Margot starved. Then Margot, carried off by typhus, left Anna to die alone. Dangerous to learn to hate hatred. To want to erase my German name, to become Jewish, to show the world I would never allow such things to happen. Do you really think it couldn't happen here? My father said. And I knew he was right. Then the nightmares came. I was in a school auditorium and all the Jewish students were told to line up and I knew what would happen and remained silent. Woke up hating myself with the cruel men in clomping boots. And I saw Anna in flames, her hollow eyes staring. Dangerous.
That's a really powerful poem.
I had very powerful feelings about that. And, you know, a certain amount of outrage.
Do you remember when you read that, or when you wrote that, I mean?
I think it was maybe a couple of years ago. It was the first banned book poem that I wrote, and then after that, I started to get more and more outraged and write more and more poems. And then I finally had a set of, I think, six, you know, half a dozen poems.
Yeah.
And then I did a reading with some actors last October. The Wyomissing Public Library agreed to hold the reading, and I got some of my actor friends. My husband did part of it, and Vicky Graff, and Susan Wagner, and Runette Gabriel. Mm-hmm. And I interspersed readings from the books that were banned.
Oh, that's...
With the poems.
With the poems. That's fantastic.
It really went well, and I'd like to do that again. I haven't...
Yeah.
You know, I haven't done it. It's a little hard to, you know, get everybody
You got to coordinate
together.
So many people.
Yeah. I've been really busy, but it went really well. The audience seemed to really enjoy it. We got a lot of people, too.
Yeah.
Including, a political candidate.
Good.
Yeah. Who was, you know, who was really happy with it. I thought we might get picketed or something, or...
You never know.
But it didn't happen.
Yeah.
You know, but that's okay. You know, if it happens, it happens.
Yeah.
So.
Read us some more of your...
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, the reading that I'm talking about started with this poem, and it's called How to Write a Banned Book.
Ooh.
So listen up. Okay. Try hard to tell the truth. Do your research. Make sure the facts are all lined up with many sources. If it's history you are writing, tell about the suffering and the glory and the hope. When you celebrate lines about justice and equality etched on parchment, do not omit the lines carved by lashes on a black back. If you are talking about triumph, look behind the lucrative factories and dig up the stories of 7-year-olds who perished working there. If you are different from the general run and withered when no one would sit with you at lunch, or when you tried to hide in the gym so that others could not ridicule your naked body, tell that suffering. Tell about how you looked in the mirror and saw a monster. Make sure anyone who reads your book knows how that feels. If you do that, your book will be banned, and everyone will want to read it.
Well, and I think one of the reasons why we're seeing so many book bannings now is because there's this the unrest caused by transgender people, intersex people, certainly the gay people started this kind of trend.
Yes, a lot of these books are about that very thing.
Yes.
About the marginalized people.
Yes.
Who are now able to have their voices heard. And there is a certain element of this society that does not want that.
Yeah, and it's got we've got such a rigid pattern about what people are supposed to be like in their adult sexual life, and it's not true.
It's not true at all. Yeah.
and we've discovered that because of science, but it's not true.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes, unfortunately, sometimes the truth makes people uncomfortable.
Yeah.
But if we don't address these things, they just get shoved into closets and under the rug, and they kind of broil up and
isn't helpful.
Yeah.
Did you want to read more of your banned book poems, or did you want to jump to the other things that you've had published in local journals?
Well, we can do something other than book banning, because that can be a little depressing. So why don't we go to the Schuylkill Valley Journal.
Okay.
Okay, and I want to, oh my goodness, I should have marked this. Let's see. I think I will read this one because I did a 5-minute poem on the other one, but there is, they actually took two of my poems, which was very nice. And this one is called, this was published, by the way, in spring, summer 2023.
Okay.
So that was last year. I have another one coming out.
Okay.
You know, pretty soon. It's called Tuba Concerto. And this was written after I watched a performance by the Philadelphia Orchestra of Wynton Marsalis's Tuba Concerto. It was written for the orchestra and their principal tuba player, Carol Jansch. And so okay. I dedicated the poem to them. And it was conducted by Yannick Nezet-Séguin, and it was amazing, as you will hear. Tuba Concerto. She stalks onto the stage, Valkyrie in a black gown, slit up to there. Broad-shouldered, muscled as an athlete, she bears the massive horn strapped on her belly. If filled with mead, it would slake the thirst of Thor. She listens to the glistening orchestra and begins. Pouring herself into that golden bell, she fills it to the brim. Out flows exultation, ecstasy, and in the depths of the giant's lowest range, lamentation. No tuba is meant to be played with the speed of a violin, those devilish runs. Has she perhaps made a pact, like Paganini? No need. This is her piece. Epic climbs, roller coaster descents, coaxing power and tenderness from metal and air. She earns thundering roars from the delirious crowd. She is the music, the tuba, the wind, and the clouds.
I love that poem.
Thank you. It was amazing. I used to do reviews all the time of concerts.
Right.
And it was nice to be able to do a poem instead of a review. I could cut out all the unnecessary stuff, you know, like when it happened, and, you know, like all that stuff. We could just get to the description.
Know what, where, who,
right,
when,
exactly.
Why,
yeah, I was free to write whatever.
Share some more of your poetry, please.
Let's see. Do you want to hear the first poem that was ever published by me? Let me see here. And this is in the Eastern Pennsylvania Poetry Review of 2021. And now I have to just find it, 125. I was surprised that they actually picked this poem as the first thing to get published. But, you know, I was happy that they did. And this one is called Invasion. First warm day of spring. First scout scurrying out from under my papers. Feeling his way on legs thin as eyelashes, reflected in the glass desktop. He's looking for a crumb, or perhaps a fragment of skin, to take back to the queen. We've seen them already, laying siege outside, climbing in neat lines up the siding, ready to invade through hairline cracks in window frames. I crush the intruder, but the next day, two more appear. Then suddenly, a roiling mob attending a congregational meeting in our porcelain bathroom sink. I pour hot water over them, wishing I had boiling oil, and most swirl down the drain. In the past, we have tried everything. Swept them into a dustpan, sprayed them with poison, even smashed them one by one, furiously with whatever lay nearby. But this year, we have the lethal weapon, diatomaceous earth, beige dust, residue of fossilized bodies of ancient plankton. We sprinkle the magic powder on their paths, puff it into tiny crevices. It would burn our eyes like pepper, but otherwise is benign enough to sprinkle on our soup. Then we wait. The next day, the troops are gone. We find tiny corpses on the counters, done in by the tiny sharp particle edges, death of a thousand cuts. Not long after, I see one ant alone, wandering in circles, wondering where he is going, and perhaps why he is here. Not unlike myself. Looming over him, giant ogress, I stamp on him, not in anger this time, but to put the poor creature out of its misery.
Susan, you are dangerous.
I am, yes. One of my friends said, this, you know, this sounds a little bit, you know, like Ahab.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
But I really, really, really hate ants. So what can I say? I was inspired by the diatomaceous earth.
Yeah, that
stuff is amazing.
Very effective.
Yeah, it's really good.
And it got you into a poetry journal.
I know. How about it? Yeah, I sent much more serious poetry out, but that's the one they wanted. So.
Well, and serious poetry. I mean, that can get pretty boring.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's good to have some humor.
Yes.
Yeah. You need a mix.
Is there anything else you'd like to share with us?
Oh, my goodness. Well, you know me. I could go on all night.
Please do.
You know, do you have a request?
No, because I don't know. I didn't get to read all of your stuff in advance, so I'm relying on you to help us.
I could do another band book poem, or I could do Barbie. I could do Barbie.
Oh, we have about 5 minutes.
Let's do Barbie.
Yes.
And that was in the Bards Against Hunger,
okay,
10-year anthology. It's a massive book of poetry by people from all over the place. And I was lucky enough to get into it. And now where is my...
I love anthologies because they give you a chance to read other
absolutely.
People from all over the country and make a lot more contacts.
Okay. Hold on, here I am with 57. Hang on, I'm almost there. This is one of the first poems I wrote when I started writing poetry seriously in 2020.
Okay.
So, and I was glad to find a home for it because I have a certain amount of affection for it. Especially when the Barbie movie came out.
So this was pre-Barbie.
It was pre-Barbie movie.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. It's called Barbie. I picked up that first Barbie at my friend's house, looked into those sly painted eyes, and lusted for her. That bleached updo, her plastic feet arched, ready for those to die for high heels, that knitted black striped one piece clinging to hard nippleless breasts. It was almost too much for my 8-year-old heart. I wanted that doll. I wanted the slinky black mermaid dress, that pink satin prom gown, the works. But my mother, no fool, knew that girl. She could see her sneaking a cigarette behind the junior high, those plastic breasts pressed against the chest of a leather-clad senior with a Harley. Mom saw right through those painted eyes. Later, Barbies looked like Sandra Dee and went out with that disappointing Ken. But the first Barbie, with her dangerous glamour, made me want to lose the safety of my childhood right there and then.
And somehow that poem takes us back to the banned books.
Mm-hmm.
Because one of the objects of banning a book is to make sure the next generation doesn't grow up too quickly.
Right.
doesn't right. have questions to ask, doesn't say, I want to be mm-hmm. that dangerous girl.
Yeah, I had no interest in baby dolls. You know, when Barbie came out, it was like, wow, I want that doll.
And I think I agree with you because I didn't really rock a baby much.
No, it was boring. I mean, you know, I would try to, like, get into that, and then I was like, you know.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
then I would just pretend they were older.
Now, you know, I was a little too old when Barbie finally came out to get a doll. Mm-hmm. But I had the fashion dolls, which were about 9 inches tall, and you could make an outfit for them.
Yeah,
but they weren't that dangerous Barbie.
That first one.
Yeah.
And then I read about the origin of Barbie, and she was based on a doll in Germany that the founder saw, like, in the different bars and taverns.
Okay.
And it was like this really slutty doll.
Really?
And that doll had nipples. And when they brought Barbie over here, they had somebody file off the nipples.
Okay.
So. So maybe I'll leave you with that story. I was like, yes, I believe that. Yeah, she was pretty slutty.
Well, we're almost at the end of the program, mm-hmm. so I want to remind my viewers that I've been talking with Susan Pena. Mm-hmm. She works very closely with Berks Bards on the board. And Berks Bards has a poetry open mic on the first Thursday of every evening. Of every month.
Yeah, yeah. In fact, this Thursday.
Yes, it is.
It's this Thursday.
Yeah, yeah. But this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it won't be.
This won't air.
Right. That, I forgot. Yeah. We're here and now, but this will be a little bit later. But
the first Thursday of every month, 6:00 in the Goggle Works. I hope to see you there.
Yes. And, yes. Please come. It is the most fun thing in the world.
Absolutely. Yeah. And you get to meet so many very different, interesting people, and they share one poem at a time what mm-hmm. their life is like.
Yeah.
And so thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.